Are we talking? Oh no.
Thank you. hearing Suzette, so we're testing with you.
Testing, testing.
One, two, three.
Good morning, church. See if this microphone works better. So glad you're here, Meg. Charles and Walter and Steve and Karen. Glad you're here, Corey, and we always miss Cleany, but we know he's with us in his heart. Good morning, Miss Gigi. Remember, you're bringing your kiddos to me right after church, I hope. I'm going to start here in just a minute. Remember to post your prayers in the comment section so that that I can get them all compiled. The youth are going to be out in the parking lot today. I figured out a way to do contactless coin drop-off. You're just going to pull up and we'll have a container for you to drop your coins in, and if you have food items, we'll snag them from your trunk or back seat or whatever, and we will feed people near and far. I'm looking forward to seeing all your faces. I would ask that you do wear a mask as you approach the youth as well. They will be wearing masks just to help keep all of us safe.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
I'm Pastor Peter, and Pastor Suzette is also here today. She'll be responding to your Facebook comments, lifting up your prayers from Facebook. If you send us prayer requests, she'll be lifting those up later. And most importantly, she'll be with the children today via this wonderful technology called Zoom. She'll be Zooming. So be sure and have your kids Zooming with us. And if you need more information about that, you can just contact the church office. Today is the 22nd Sunday in this season of Ordinary Time, where we are counting the Sundays. Each Sunday is a mini Easter. I'm so glad that all of you are here today as we celebrate our faith in the risen Lord. Now, please remember that we, every day, we collect food for Hill Country Community Ministries. Lots of people are in need, and Bob Bowker is our wonderful liaison to that organization. He comes by and looks in the box to see if you've brought food, and tears start streaming down his face when he sees an empty box. So please, don't forget, you know, if you send curbside or if you have home delivery, order a few cans of extra food for Hill Country, and Bob will even come by your house and pick it up if need be. Now, importantly, he'll be here Tuesday at 10 o'clock in the parking lot, and there's another opportunity to bring food up for Hill Country, and Suzette will tell you about that later in the service. Our UMW unit is also collecting diaper wipes and diaper cream for Acts of Love Daycare. It's the school for teen mothers. They take care of the children while their teen moms are in school, but while that program is just going online right now, we are still collecting supplies for them, and Sue Sidney is up here on Wednesday mornings in the church office, and you can bring diaper wipes or diaper cream up to church during that time, or contact her for how you can get those to her. Now, in September, I'm going to begin a six-week study of the Sermon on the Mount using a wonderful book written by Professor Amy Jill Levine, who is a scholar, one of the foremost scholars in first century Christianity and Judaism. She's written a six-week series on the Sermon on the Mount, and we'll be starting that September the 10th. You'll need a copy of the book that you can get for $15, but if you're interested, please let me know that, because we'll be starting a week from this Thursday. Let us now together worship God. Thank you. Amen. I invite you now to join me for the greeting. Glory in God's name.
May you know the peace of God to all the earth.
Seek the strength of the Lord. Join me now in singing, Let's Sing Unto the Lord. Let's sing unto the Lord a hymn of glad rejoicing. Let's sing a hymn of love at the new day's fresh beginning. God made the sky above, the stars, the sun, the ocean. God saw it was good, for those works were filled with beauty. Alleluia, alleluia, let's sing unto the Lord. Alleluia, let's sing unto the Lord a hymn of adoration, which shows our love and faith and the hope of all creation. All that has been made, the Lord is praised for greatness. So we sing to God who bestows such lovely blessings. Alleluia, alleluia. Let's sing unto the Lord. Alleluia.
Pastor Suzette,
let's sing unto the Lord. Alleluia. Let us pray. We're still working at the kinks, y'all. God among us, we gather in the name of your Son to learn love for one another. Turn our feet from evil paths, our hands from shameful deeds, our minds to your wisdom, and our hearts to your glory. We ask this in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones to him belong, they are weak, but yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, the Bible tells me so.
Good morning. You can unmute yourself now.
Good morning.
So glad you're here. Tell Leland to get in here.
Leland, come on.
Come on, Leland.
Leland.
Yeah, we learned.
Hey, Ready.
Look, who I have here.
What's that?
A bunny.
What is that?
It's a little bunny.
It's a bunny. It's my friend Bunny.
Okay.
Let me take off my mask now so I can actually talk. All right. So this is my friend. He's a bunny. Actually, he's a rabbit. Guess what his name is?
What?
Yes.
Clover?
Clover, that's cute. I like that name. No.
Fuzzy?
Fuzzy, that's another good one. What about you, Rachel? What would you name the bunny? You're muted, Rachel.
What?
What would you name the bunny?
I would name him Silver.
Ah, I like that. Well, this is actually the rabbit Peter. Peter, this is Leland and Josie and Rachel, and I'm pretty sure there might be James and Elizabeth watching elsewhere. So Peter came to visit us to tell us a story, didn't you, Peter? Would you like to hear a story from Peter? Yes? All right. So, Peter, you were a friend of Jesus, right? Yes, I was a friend of Jesus. What was it like to follow Jesus? It was wonderful. We got to go around and help people and feed people and do all sorts of amazing things. It was so much fun. And it was really fun when he made the people who were really smart seem kind of silly. Wouldn't that be kind of fun to do? Would you like to be able to do that? Yeah, it had to be pretty cool to be walking around with Jesus and doing all that fun stuff. It was so much fun, and I didn't want it to end, ever. But what, Peter? One day Jesus told us it was going to end. Really? Yeah, he said he was going to end, and he was going to go to prison, and they were going to hurt him. And I didn't want that, so I said, no. I told him, no, no, no. Really? And what happened then? Well, Jesus got mad at me. Really? Yeah, he did. He got mad at me. Because he said that I was telling him what I wanted him to be instead of letting Jesus do what Jesus had to do. I was telling Jesus to follow me instead of me following Jesus. He said I had to let go of what I thought Jesus should be and do what God said Jesus to be. I didn't feel very good for a moment. But you know what? Jesus said, come and follow me. He still was my friend. He's the best friend ever. Wow, that's pretty cool friendship there. Yeah. Do you think people still do that? Do you think people still tell Jesus what Jesus should be instead of letting Jesus be Jesus?
Yeah.
We can like Jesus, but sometimes we tell him what we want him to be instead of doing what we're supposed to be doing. Well, what happens then? Well, you ask for forgiveness. And then Jesus says, come and follow, and you get to try again. It's pretty cool. Well, thank you for sharing your story with us, Peter. You're welcome. Would you like to pray with us as we go? Sure. All right, let's hold our pause. Repeat after me, dear God, thank you for loving us, for sending us Jesus, who teaches us how to be good people serving you, and most importantly, forgives us when we want to change it. Help us shine Jesus' light everywhere we go. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right. Bye, my friends. Can you say bye to Peter?
Bye. Thank you for the M&Ms. Bye.
See you later.
Bye, Peter. Bye.
There you go. All right, y'all. Close out your Facebook accounts.
Jesus loves me, the Bible tells me so.
We're going to sing a medley of hymns now, beginning with All Hail the Power of Jesus' Name.
All hail the power of Jesus' Name, let angels prostrate fall. Bring forth the royal diadem and crown him Lord of all.
him and crown him Lord of all. Ye chosen seed of Israel's race, ye ransomed from the fall. Hail him who saves you by his grace and crown him Lord of all. Hail him who saves you by his grace and crown him Lord of all. Sinners whose love can ne'er forget the wormwood and the gall, go spread your trophies at his feet and crown him Lord of all. Go spread your trophies at his feet and crown him Lord of all. Let every kindred, every tribe on this terrestrial ball, to him all majesty ascribe and crown him Lord of all. To him all majesty ascribe and crown him Lord of all. Crown him, ye martyrs of your God, who from his altar call, extol the stem of Jesse's rod and crown him Lord of all. Extol the stem of Jesse's rod and crown him Lord of all. Oh, that with yonder sacred throne we at his feet may fall, we'll join the everlasting song and crown him Lord of all. We'll join the everlasting song and crown him Lord of all. My Jesus, I love thee, I know thou art mine. For thee all the follies of sin I resign. My gracious Redeemer, my Savior art thou. If ever I love, my Jesus, 'tis now. I love thee because thou hast first loved me and purchased my pardon on Calvary's tree. I love thee for wearing the thorns on my brow. If ever I love thee, thy Jesus 'tis now. In mansions of glory and endless delight, I'll ever adore thee in heaven so bright. I'll sing with the glittering on my brow. If ever I love thee, thy Jesus 'tis now. Ask ye what great thing I know that delights and stirs me so. What the high reward I win, whose the name I glory in. Jesus Christ the crucified, who defeats my fiercest foes, who consoles my saddest woes, who revives my fainting heart, healing hearts, hidden smart, Jesus Christ the crucified, who is life in life to me, who the death of death will be, who will place me on his right with the countless pulse of life, Jesus Christ the crucified. This is that great thing I know, this delights and stirs me so, faith in him who died to save, him who triumphed o'er the grave, Jesus Christ the crucified. I invite you to pray with me now the prayer for illumination as we prepare to hear today's scripture lesson. Gracious God, we do not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from your mouth. Make us hungry for this heavenly food, that it may nourish us today in the ways of eternal life, through Jesus Christ, the bread of heaven. Amen. Today's scripture lesson comes to us from the 12th chapter of Paul's letter to the church in Rome. Hear this word. Let love be genuine. Hate what is evil. Hold fast to what is good. Love one another with mutual affection. Outdo one another in showing honor. Do not lag in zeal. Be ardent in spirit. Serve the Lord. Rejoice in hope. Be patient in suffering. Persevere in prayer. Contribute to the needs of the saints. Extend hospitality to strangers. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse them. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Weep with those who weep. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be haughty, but associate with the lowly. Do not claim to be wiser than you are. Do not repay anyone evil for evil, but take thought for what is noble in the sight of all. If it is possible, so far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all. Beloved, never avenge yourselves, but leave room for the wrath of God, for it is written, "Vengeance is mine, I will repay," says the Lord. Now, if your enemies are hungry, feed them. If they are thirsty, give them something to drink, for by doing this you will heap burning coals on their heads. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Here in this 12th chapter of his letter to the Romans, the Apostle Paul, I think, is preaching his own version of the Sermon on the Mount. In 12 short verses, he churns out 30 instructions, all of them meant to put flesh on the bones of Christ's commandment to love. I think Paul had good reason for going to so much trouble. The church in Rome may have been splitting apart in two different ways, inside by conflict between Jewish and Gentile Christians, and outside by conflict between Christian and non-Christian Romans. There were black eyes and bad feelings all over the place. Marcus went to the midweek service so he wouldn't have to sit in the same room with Clovis on Sunday. Lucius was so mad at them both that he had quit coming to church altogether. And Chloe had just bought herself a pit bull to keep her pagan neighbors from cutting across her yard. It was a mess all the way around. People said they believed that God was love. They said they believed in the power of goodness, at least until someone crossed them. When that happened, goodness and love pretty much fell by the wayside. Retaliation turned out to be what they really believed in. Now, if you've ever been on the receiving end of a really grievous wrong, then you know how the mind tends to process what happened. This is wrong, you tell yourself. I am in a lot of pain. This should not have happened to me. Someone's got to pay for this. Evildoers have to be stopped, and if I don't do it, someone else will get hurt. It's really not my nature, but I've got to strike back. I will fight fire with fire. God is a God of justice, right? What has happened to me is not right, and someone's going to pay. That's how it usually goes. Don't get mad, it says on our coffee cups. Get even. So the lawsuits get filed. The insult is returned. The line is drawn. And the Cold War begins, full of stony silence and clenched teeth. Because something deep down inside us believes that we will be annihilated if we don't fight back. But according to Paul, that's not the right way to go about doing things. Do not repay anyone evil for evil, Paul writes to the Romans. But take thought for what is noble in the sight of all. Paul's advice here may be idealistic, it may be impractical, it may be dangerous to our health, but there it is. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. All I can figure is Paul had this incredible faith in the power of love, faith that most of us either do not share or are not eager to put to the test. He seemed to understand that the real enemy is not the one who pushes us down on the playgrounds of life. The real enemy is whatever it is inside us that wants to leap up and push back. Evil is never satisfied with controlling only one side of a situation. Its goal is to infect everyone involved, the victim along with the bully, the plaintiff along with the defendant, the offended along with the offender. When everyone has his dukes in the air, when there is a loaded gun in every household, then the enemy will have won. Because the whole point is to recruit the good guys by making them believe they are stopping the bad guys. That's not how to do it, Paul says. No. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse them. Because the moment you curse them, you join them. And however good it may feel at the moment, it is still a surrender. The only way to conquer evil is to absorb it, Paul says. Take it into yourself and disarm it. Neutralize its acids. Serve as a charcoal filter for its smog. Suck it up. Put a straitjacket on it and turn it over to God so that when you breathe out again, the air is pure. Now, this is an incredible dare. And Paul apparently knows very few of us will accept it unless there's something in it for us. So he adds a little bonus near the end. He says, if your enemies are hungry, feed them. If they're thirsty, give them something to drink, for by doing this, you will heap burning coals on their heads. Nice little speech there, Paul. Convince us to care for our enemies by telling us how much it will hurt them if we do. Now, I really don't know what this crazy sentence is all about. Martin Luther thought it meant that those who are converted by love burn against themselves once they've discovered what they've been missing. All I know is the first half of the sentence makes the second half harmless. People who come upon their enemies in a weakened state and who resist the temptation to take advantage of them, who help them instead, who give the ones who've hurt them food and drink, those people are already out of danger. By the time they've packed the picnic basket and filled the thermos with pink lemonade, I guarantee you they will have forgotten all about the burning coals part. Do I not conquer my enemy, said Abraham Lincoln, by making him my friend? Now, there is nothing sentimental or the least bit easy about any of this. There's not even a guarantee that it will work. But one thing is for sure. When we repay evil with evil, evil is all there is, in bigger and more toxic piles. The only way to reverse the process is to behave in totally unexpected ways, blessing the persecutor, feeding the enemy, embracing the bully, breaking that vicious cycle by refusing to participate in it anymore. That's what love is, says Paul. It's not a warm feeling between two like-minded friends. It's just plain old imitation of Christ, who took all the meanness of this world and ran it through the filter of his own body, repaying evil with good, blame with pardon, and death with life. I guess you could call it divine reverse psychology. It worked once, and it can work again whenever God can find someone else who's willing to give it a try. And let all God's people say, Amen. As a response to the word, I invite you to say with me now the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven, is seated at the right hand of the Father, and will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. We turn our hearts now to God in prayer, and I invite you to sing with me now verses 1 and 2 of Lord, Speak to Me. Lord, speak to me that I may speak in living echoes of thy tone. As thou hast sought, so let me seek thine erring children lost and lone. Oh, strengthen me that while I stand firm on the rock and strong in thee, I may stretch out a love. hope you brought a candle for our prayer time together. I'm going to light a candle here in this space in just a moment, and you write yours and make a sacred space for us together, and we'll be praying. Turning to God in prayer, I invite you to share any prayer concerns you may have by typing a comment in the comment box and sending it, and then later on in the service, Suzette will be lifting that up in prayer. Let's all go ahead and light our candles right now. Number of prayer concerns that we need to lift up. We definitely want to pray for Andy Carver, who had some very serious surgery and is trying to do rehabilitation work at Encompass Rehab Facility. We continue to lift up Mary Linden, Adelaide Verostigi, and their new situation. We pray for Martha Orr's brother David, who's seriously ill in a hospital. We lift up Rachel Longoria's teacher, Mrs. Simpson, who was bit by a snake and is trying to teach with a very severe ankle. We lift up Marianne Moser's sister Stella, who is suffering from COVID in Corpus Christi. And we are deepened by, and our tears are offered to Duane and Marianne on the death of Duane's sister Kathy. We need to pray for Duane's family, especially his 86-year-old mother, who is grieving the loss of a daughter. Let's sing now verses 3 and 4 of Lord Speak to Me. Oh, teach me, Lord, that I may teach the precious things thou dost impart, and wing my words that they may reach the hidden depths of many a heart. Oh, fill me with thy fullness, Lord, until my very heart o'erflow in kindling thought and glowing word, thy love to tell, thy praise to show.
His mother's daughter, Kathy. We also lift up Duane and Marianne's family for her sister Stella's fighting COVID that has moved into the kidneys and her liver. And we just ask your healing presence and your overwhelming peace flood into that space. Edna asks for prayers for Miriam Pagan, who has been diagnosed with cancer of the heart. And it is not a good outlook for her. And Corey lifts all the residents who are under isolation and all who are dealing with COVID in all its various forms, whether physical illness or financial strife or isolation and loneliness. We ask that you strengthen us to deal with what we must face. Corey also asks for peace and healing within the family strife with her daughter, that hearts will be turned and peace can be made. Scylla's asked for prayers for Greta's grandson, who has hip surgery this Thursday. Karen asked for, gives praise to God for keeping Kyle and Morgan and all those who participated in the Martin Luther King Memorial March in D.C. safe and peaceful. I lift up the Rios family and friends in San Marcos at the suicide of their teenage son, for the emptiness that follows such a grievous act. And Martha lifts up her brother in Augusta, struggling at the end of life, that he may feel her love and the presence of God in these end times. Margaret McClintock says, ask that all teachers and students be kept safe in the schools that are meeting in person, and to be present with those who are dealing with online issues, patience for both the students and the teachers as they continue in this uncharted territory. So God, we ask that you be present in all these ways that we have lifted up, and that you move into those that we cannot even speak aloud, places where the hurt is deep, the fear is strong. Be a light in a moment of reprieve. Help us to remember that you are God and you are mighty. You have created the earth and the space and all of us in this time, and you do not leave us. You will never abandon us. No matter how we feel, you are steadfast and present in each and every single moment, for every breath that we have, in our life beyond life. You call us home. And in all things, we give you thanks most of all for Jesus, who taught us to pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Thy blessed face I see, thy rest, thy joy, thy glory share.
Good? All right, church. And I don't know how to do that, so I went and prayed. And God and I had a conference, and we've come up with a way to do it. This is our handy-dandy cart. When you come to the church parking lot, you're going to drive in, and the youth will be waiting there with the cart. Some people came by early. You just roll down your window, and you just put your money in. One more. So it would be this far away. We'll have masks on. We ask that you wear your mask when your window is down as well, so that our youth are not exposed either. And if you want to also bring items for the food pantry, I was at Costco and I picked up spaghetti and spaghetti sauce. If you put that in your back seat or in your trunk, one of the other youth will run around and grab it and take it out so that we can see each other, wave to each other, help feed those that are really super hungry, because the potato fund is still working as hard as ever to collect unused food and distribute it around the country. And of course, the HCCM, we know, is really struggling to meet its needs. Together, yet apart. All you have to do is come into the parking lot, come on through, and the youth will be there to wave at you and gather your resources, and then we will get them where they need to go from there. Thank you. Today, thank you very much. Today from noon to 1. That's it, just that one little hour. That gives you time to come by, drop it off, and go back and do Sunday school with Sergio. So it's a small window, but it's an important window. So come on by and make Bob smile. That's it.
And now a moment to lift your soul with Jodi. Amen. We'll sing our final hymn now, Hal Hobson's The Gift of Love. Go in peace. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all now and forever. Amen. We turn to the side now and sing our song of going forth.
Shalom to you now. Shalom. God's full mercy bless you, my friends. In all your living and through your loving, Christ be your shalom. Christ be your shalom.